Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. My dear students, today we are going to talk about gastrointestinal bleeding, which means it's upper GI or lower GI. Gastrointestinal bleeding comprises upper and lower intestinal bleeding. Difference is defined by location of source of bleeding, either proximal or distal to ligament or treats, or duodenal suspensory ligament that attaches the junction of duodenum and jejunum. Epidemiology. Upper and lower GI bleed, more common is upper, 5:1. The incidence is 50 to 100 per 100,000 patients. 30% are older than 65 years, 80% are self-limited, and 20% have recurrent bleed within 48 to 72 hours, and they have poor prognosis. Most deaths caused by GI bleeding occur in patients older than 60. Upper GI bleeding is more common in men than women, 2:1. Whereas lower GI bleeding is more common in women. Significant upper GI bleeding requiring admission is more common in adults, whereas lower GI bleeding requires admission is more common in children. Clinical features. Hematemesis is vomiting of blood, clots or coffee grounds, is suggestive of an upper GI source. Hematochezia, the passage of liquid blood or clots per rectum, 3 to 4 colonic source. In 75% there is a colonic source. In 11% the source is proximal to ligament or treats. Melina, stools with altered blood that are black and tarry and have a distinct odor is suggestive of upper GI source and may continue for days till bleeding stops. Occult bleeding, initial presence of and or positive fecal occult blood, but no visible blood in feces. Obscure bleeding is recurrent or persistent bleeding, positive fecal occult blood or visible bleeding with no bleeding source found at regional endoscopy. This is upper GI bleeding hematemesis. This is, we have already defined this. Incidence of upper GI bleeding is 150 patients per 100,000 population per year. Overall mortality is 10%. In those admitted to hospital, and mortality is 30% in the elderly. 1 in 1,000 patients in United States who experienced upper GI bleeding, men twice common in male than females. 50% present with hematemesis, 11% have brisk bleeds that have hematochezia, and melena develops approximately 150 to 200 cc's of blood in upper GI tract. This is when melena occurs. Stools turn black after 8 hours of sitting within the gut. This is the comparison of site of bleeding, recurrence of bleeding, mortality rate. If it is a peptic ulcer, incidence of recurrent bleed is 10 to 32%, and mortality is 3 to 8%. If it is varices, recurrence is much higher, 42 to 70%, and mortality rate is naturally higher, 20 to 30%. And if it's a Mallory-Weiss syndrome or a tear, the recurrent bleed is about 9 to 13%, mortality is low. This is the etiology of upper GI bleed. The commonest are the duodenal ulcer, which is 25%, or gastric erosions, another 25%, or gastric ulcer, 20%, varices, 10%. And the rare causes, no diagnosis found, and esophagitis and Mallory-Weiss fill in the rest. This is what we have just gone through, and this is another picture showing the incidence of upper GI bleed. For example, if it is esophagitis, 10% usually with hiatus hernia. If it is peptic ulcer, which is 35 to 50%, causes NSAIDs or H. pylori here and there. If it was a malformation here or there, or a iatro-duodenal fistula, which is a rare combination, or CA of the stomach or esophagus, 2%, and gastric erosions, alcohol or NSAIDs, stomach, 10 to 20%, Mallory-Weiss, again low incidence, and cirrhosis, liver disease or portal vein thrombosis, 2 to 9%. This is how a duodenal ulcer will look. On the left, it's a duodenal ulcer which is not bleeding, and on the right, a bleeding duodenal ulcer. This is a gastric ulcer. On the left, not bleeding, on the right, bleeding. These are look of varices. This is how the varices look like. On the left, they are not bleeding. On the right, they are bleeding. This is varices, even worse. This is Mallory-Weiss syndrome, and this is esophagitis. Going through these. This is angiodysplasia of the stomach. This is a malformation, arteriovenous malformation. This is esophageal CA, and this is gastric CA. So these are typical appearances on endoscopy. And this is a duodenal ulcer, and this is also duodenal ulcer picture shown. Peptic ulcer occurs when there is a break in the epithelial surface. For example, there is ulceration of the esophagus, stomach or duodenum. As the name indicates, it occurs in places where there is flow of pepsin. So peptic ulcer includes duodenal ulcer and a gastric ulcer. Peptic ulcer occurs more than 300,000 hospital admissions annually in the United States. The incidence is 103 cases per 100,000 adults per year. Mortality between 5 to 14%, is unchanged for the last two decades, exclusively among elderly patients with significant comorbidities. Common causes of peptic ulcer: infection with H. pylori, use of NSAIDs, and other suspects like alcohol, smoking, and stress. Number three, imbalance between the aggressive and the protective mechanisms. And number four, acid hypersecretion due to increased number of parietal cells as seen in Zollinger-Ellison syndrome. What are risk factors in various conditions? In H. pylori, 70-90% in non-bleeding duodenal ulcers and lower in bleeding ulcers and gastric ulcers. NSAIDs or aspirins dose dependent increased risk of ulcers and bleeding with doses as low as 75 mg per day, including aspirin, acetyl salicylic acid. Corticosteroids plus NSAIDs little increased risk when used alone, and the risk increases with NSAIDs and steroids. Thus the complication twice common, GI bleeding 10 times common. Oral anticoagulants increase risk of bleeding versus controls alone 3.3 and with NSAIDs 12.7. What is the role of acid in hemostasis? Impairs clot formation in the form of impairing platelet aggregation and causes disaggregation. Accelerates clot lysis, predominantly acid-stimulated pepsin, and may impair integrity of mucus or bicarbonate barrier. What are the features of peptic ulcer? Males more commonly infected than females, age group 20 to 50 years, epigastric pain during fasting, hunger pain relieved by food and antacids, back pain if ulcer is penetrating posteriorly, hematemesis from ulcer penetrating gastroduodenal artery posteriorly, can lead to peritonitis if ulcer occurs anteriorly, that is anterior acute perforation, and can lead to pyloric stenosis. The Forest classification of peptic ulcer bleeding is F1 active bleeding, F1A spurting arterial bleed, F1B oozing bleeding, F2 signs of recent hemorrhage, F2A visible vessel on the base, 2B coagulum in the ulcer, 2C coffee ground ulcer base, and F3 no sign of bleeding. These are the various Forest classification of GI bleed as I already described endoscopically. How do the peptic ulcers bleed? Spontaneous stopping occurs in 70-80% probability of rebleed in 30-50% rebleed within 24-48 hours. In 70-80%. And mortality among patients operated because of rebleeding is about 20-30%. I think this is a pure endoscopic prognostic factors in patients with non-variceal upper GI bleed. I think we don't need to go through the details. Gastric ulcer is of two types. One is type 1, which is more common in males in 50 plus. Epigastric pain induced by eating, and this weight loss, nausea, vomiting, and anemia from chronic blood loss. And type 2 is same as a peptic ulcer or duodenal ulcer. This is Mallory White syndrome, how it looks like on an endoscopy. It causes a sudden increase of intragastric pressure after alcohol intoxication. And there is rupture of the mucosa in the cardia. The treatment is usually conservative and does not require any surgery. This is esophagitis seen through an endoscope. Erosions occur in the GIT and associated with alcohol intake, NSAIDs, salicylate containing drugs and steroids. Other illnesses, cardiorespiratory, vascular trauma, burns and post-operative conditions. So this covers the upper GI bleed and now the lower GI bleed. Incidence is much less than upper GI bleed. The rate of hospitalization is 1/5 of upper GI bleed. Shock is less common, it occurs in only 15% of patients. In severe GI, lower GI bleed, the bleeding lesion is located in the right side of the colon in 75% of cases. In 6% of patient of severe lower GI bleed, the bleeding site is not identified even after extensive investigations, and bleeding usually ceases spontaneously. So definition we have already described is bleeding derived from any source distal to ligament of treats. It may be frank or occult. Occult will cause anemia. When the frank shows a small bleed or a massive bleed. These are the etiology of lower GI bleed. And you start from the common things, hemorrhoids, fissure, carcinoma warts, and then diverticular diseases, the disease of the vest, colitis, ulcerative colitis, polyps, carcinomas, angiodysplasia occurs in elderly, the right side of the colon, carcinoma of the right side, and Meckel's diverticulum intersection, enteritis and Crohn's disease. These are the small lesions in the small gut. And these are the various incidences, more so site of bleeding is 74% in the colon, 11% in upper GIT, 9% in small bowel, and no site found in 6%. Usually in 15% it's severe and 80% it's 85% is mild and is usually corrects on conservative management. These are the most common causes. The incidences, for example, the angiodysplasia, one is on the right side, angiodysplasia and diverticular disease is on the left side. The less common are carcinoma, kidney colitis, inflammatory bowel disease that includes Crohn's and ulcerative colitis. And the rare ones, solitary rectal ulcer, Meckel's diverticulum, polyps, anterior aortoenteric fistula. So this is what the diverticular look like on endoscope. So this is disease of the vest. This is a bleeding occurs due to erosion of an artery within the mouth of the diverticulum, and it almost always stops spontaneously. If the bleeding continues or is recurrent, the disease segment of colon need to be dissected after maybe confirmation of the site by angiography or colonoscopy. In Meckel's diverticulum, there is ectopic gastric epithelium which may ulcerate and erode into a major artery. A diagnosis should be considered in children or adolescent who present with profuse or recurrent lower GI bleed. A Meckel's 99 technician per technique scan is sometimes positive, but the diagnosis is commonly made only by laparotomy, at which time the diverticulum is excised. This is how the angiodysplasia of the colon occur. Angiodysplasia of the colon is a disease of the elderly in which there is vascular malformation in the proximal colon. Bleeding can be acute and profuse, usually stops spontaneously but commonly recurs, and diagnosis is often difficult. Colonoscopy sometimes reveals characteristic vascular spots which are reminiscent of spider nevi. In acute bleeding, visceral angiography might help. In some patients, diagnosis is only achieved by laparotomy with on-table colonoscopy. The treatment of choice is endoscopic thermal ablation, but resection of the affected colon may be required if it is recurrent. Ischemic colitis, on the other hand, is due to occlusion of the inferior mesenteric artery and presents with abdominal colic and retracted bleed. It should be considered in elderly patients who have had evident generalized atherosclerosis, and diagnosis is made at colonoscopy and resection is required only in presence of peritonitis. This is how ischemic colitis will look like. This is a typical picture of ulcerative colitis. On left you have normal colon with normal hostral pattern, and on the right, the middle one, you got mild ulcerative colitis, and on the extreme right you got severe ulcerative colitis. This is Crohn disease, somewhat different from ulcerative colitis. This is what the endoscopic picture is, whereas confirmation is done by biopsy. These are how colonic polyps look like. Some are pedunculated, others are sessile. This is how a carcinoma of the colon looks. These are hemorrhoids, internal hemorrhoids. Here, these are non-bleeding and this one is bleeding. Basically, hemorrhoidal bleeding is bright red and occurs during or after defecation. Proctoscopy is used to make the diagnosis, but in subjects who have altered bowel habit and in all patients presenting at over 40 years of age, colonoscopy or barium enema is necessary to exclude coexisting colorectal carcinoma. Anal fissure should be suspected when a fresh rectal bleed occurs, and severe anal pain occurs during defecation and continues for quite some time afterwards. Now, a few words about chronic or occult GI bleed. Slow bleeding into GIT tract occurs up to 200 ml per day. It may signify a serious gastrointestinal lesion and usually present as a chronic iron deficiency anemia. The most common cause worldwide is hookworm infestation. The other cause is colorectal carcinoma, especially that of the cecum, which may have no gastrointestinal symptoms. Therefore, present late and have anemia and dyspepsia and weight loss. So these are the common causes of occult bleeding chronic neoplasm, duodenal ulcer, esophagitis, or visceral ulcer, gastric ulcer, NSAID, aspirin-induced erosion and gastritis, gastric carcinoma, Meckel's, and angiodysplasia. And investigate them by FOBs, do a colonoscopy, right? If colonoscopy is negative, then do an upper GI endoscopy. If both are negative, then investigate the small bowel. For example, do a capsule endoscopy or small bowel through an X-ray or a small bowel through an enteroscopy or a Meckel scan, or even endoscopy may have to be considered. Management in cult GIT bleed is naturally you find primary source of bleeding and treat it and replenish iron stores, and serious recurrent symptomatic anemia may require repeated transfusions. Just a reminder, much more to come. Are we still awake? Management. This is the management. You assess the patient, airway, breathing, circulation, resuscitate the patient, IV access, blood transfusion, do lab tests, risk assessment, severe, moderate, or mild, as we have already gone through, and then subject to endoscopy. Well, low risk region, medical treatment, high risk, endoscopic treatment. If it re-bleeds, we consider surgery. This is an outline, normal outline, and this is what we have just gone through. This occurs in developed countries. They even look for all these before bringing the patient to hospital. Put up a CVP line, give oxygen. They may give painkillers or even start Hemaxyl. So let's hope we can use these huge saline as well. So they bring a patient in relatively much better state as compared to what we have. So emergency medical treatment includes transfusions, platelet or fresh frozen or packed cells, right? No deep need to go into detail. These are the manifestations we just gone through doing an endoscopy, right? Brief history, we've been through this. These are graphic view of what we have already discussed. These are some of the initial diagnostic studies. Actually, if you were to fully investigate these patients, we've just been through it. The Rockall risk scoring scheme compare the age 60, less than 60, 60, 79, 80. These are the various risk scores. Probably too high for you. The secondary management of endoscopy, tract therapy, octreotide, vasopressin, protein pump inhibitors, antacids, balloon tamponade, even surgery. Alright, the interventional radiology. Just been through them. Lower GI bleed and upper GI bleed. This is a flow chart. This is what an endoscopy looks. You have been through it. Laser therapy being done. Injection therapy being done. Loop sutures and balloon treatment, hemostatic clips, all they are done. Snare polypectomy done in polyps. Clipping of the artery or right. There are some of the advantages and disadvantages of angiography probably not required at your stage. Embolization. Vasopressin, super selective embolization, the topics beyond undergraduate level. We have gone through, I will just run through some of the approach. Conclusion: approach to GI bleeding depends on the hemodynamic status of the patient. Rapid stabilization is required if signs and symptoms of shock or severe blood loss are present. Once the patient is stable, determine the likely source of bleeding. Vomiting, blood, melena, and bright red streaks in the feces suggest upper GI bleed. Such patients require early endoscopy. Diarrhea, blood stained or stools, or containing blood, more typical of the GI bleed, and is evaluated with colonoscopy. Modern endoscopic therapeutic techniques have eliminated the need for surgery in most patients with GI bleed, but surgical consultation should always be obtained. And thank you very much.